Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Awkward Analysis with Chromoid. Today we're going to be reviewing Death in the Shape of a Panzer Battalion. As you can see behind me, it is quite the fearsome looking entry, and it is submitted by Aerolfos. And it will be also competing in the next, I believe the next match that we will see as soon as the From the Depths form is back up. Seems someone over at BBSLQ or SQL or whatever the site that hosts the forum is currently down, and so of course I can't access my PMs and download the latest episode sent to me by my trusty editor Monk Lizard. So yeah, you're getting this video instead. Whenever, you know, if you check my channel at all, you'll get it before most others, because I won't be able to post it on the forum, of course, till the forum is up again. So yeah, it's kind of a never-ending cycle. I hope someone notices this. Maybe a few of the very few people who are subscribed will take note and get to see it a little early. But yeah, this is the best I can do for today. Technology has thwarted my attempts to bring you an actual battle. But yeah, this is the tank entry for Aerolfos. Let's take a look at it. We have here two mammoth tanks. Well, they're mammoths. They're not mammoth tanks. I just call them mammoth tanks. And then we have three full-stop light tanks here. And in the middle, this thing is the Demolition Tank Destroyer. So, since there's only one of these, I'm going to go ahead and jump into the Tank Destroyer first and review it. I may have to turn off the sound here, because, again, it's crackling and I just can't stand that. So there we go. Yeah, my throat's a bit dry. Not sure why. Alright, let's look at this thing. A lot of ERA on the outside. I'm going to go ahead and turn on the HUD so I can see this. I want to look at the steering real quick, because there's a lot of wheels on here. And I think it's differential. Yeah, it looks like it's differential steering. Whoops. I thought that was two layers of wheels. There's only one layer of wheels. It just has these, has a double layer on the front and back to make it look like the tracks are that wide. They're not really that wide. You can see, whoops, underneath there. And you can also see the engine's a bit exposed. But yes, this is a variable drive. It's controlled not by steering wheels, but by, you know, reversing the tracks or making them go forward, like a real tank. And there's the setup there. So obviously, they move forward and backwards by control of the AI, but to move left and right, the AI controls ACBs, which then control the wheels. I've explained this in numerous videos before, so if you don't understand, go back and watch some of my first awkward analysis videos. Let me think here. Right off the top of my head, ones I could think of are the Corner Cutters by GXY. That was one of the first ones I did. Also had variable drive in it. Just giving you it's a neat little alternative method to the normal steering wheel solution. But yes, this is a cram tank, as you can tell by the massive barrel protruding out. And as per the rules, cram tanks cannot use turrets. So it is a forward-facing casemate enclosed cannon. It does have, you know, however much angle of, or however many angle degrees of depression, elevation, and a traverse that the barrel inherently has. And there's a lot of motor-driven barrels on this, so I'm assuming, yep, down there in the bottom of the, see the UI there, it says 45 azimuth and 45 elevation firing arc. That's the best you can get out of these guns. 45-45 is the best kind of elevation and azimuth. So it has a decent amount of coverage, but still, it is a forward-facing gun, so you can be flanked very easily. And it has to rely on the AI to turn it towards its target, which is always a dubious proposition. Anyway, up here we have two missile launchers. These are rather, well, about average for the length. There's six each, so that's 12 of the 36 allowed gantries just for this tank. Let's take a look at them here. They look like they're both the same thing. We do have two fins, a variable thruster. 6120. I'm assuming there is a mathematical reason they're set exactly like this. Normally, I just go for, you know, something by a magnitude of 1,000. I could do, you know, 500, 1,000, 1,500, 2,000. I've never seen anyone do, you know, exact numbers like this. And I'm sure there's a very good reason, but I can't think of any right now. Interestingly enough, the ramp time is a bit slower than is the what am I thinking of here? Sorry, someone's dog is barking overhead. It's really distracting me. The standard setting, when you put in a variable thruster, it's usually set at 1. This is set at 0.8, so it actually ramps up just a hair faster than the average variable thruster does. Not much, but it does get going. Basically, if the ramp time determines how fast this thruster will get up to full speed, you can delay it all the way up to 10 seconds. It takes 10 seconds to reach its maximum thrust. This one's set to just a bit faster than a second. 0.8 seconds to get to full speed, so it's a little faster. Also has a slightly longer warhead arming delay than most. 2 is the normal or the standard setting when you load in a missile, and it's been increased by 0.2. That may be an accident. Some of these do change when you use the scroll wheel and you happen to be near them. So you see how I'm doing right there. That could have been the case, but it's interesting. I've never seen exact numbers put in like this. That's interesting. We do have 3 fragmentation warheads. Let's look at how they're set up. There's a 30-degree frag cone, 10-degree frag cone, and another 10-degree frag cone. So these are set. The first one's what I call a splash cone. It will soften up armor in a radius around the impact point. And then the next two are narrow frags that punch through the centerpiece and hopefully one or two blocks on the sides. So this one just kind of softens up the outer layer to get these through a little easier. And then, of course, we do have 3 explosive warheads, which will do a lot towards softening up the exterior armor. Explosive warheads have gotten a buff in recent months, and that has definitely helped them to be a bit of a better, surface scrubber. So these plus this first fragmentation warhead will definitely make it easier for these last two to penetrate deep into the tank. And against it's capped by a laser designator receiver. If you want accuracy over raw firepower, designator receivers are your surest bet, especially with something that does not have a turret like this. They will have the ability to curve towards their targets much better than a laser beam rider receiver, which has a very narrow cone of vision behind. It basically looks behind the missile and tries to find the laser within a certain cone with a very narrow view cone. If the laser is not found, it'll just travel forward. Basically, you really want the laser to kind of, and the missile to kind of be on mostly the same line. If there's slight adjustments, it will change course. But the only real benefit to using a rider receiver is you can put it back here in the back of the missile and put something else on the front of the missile. That's the only guidance module that does that. Everything else has to be in the nose cone. But this does give it better accuracy, and these are very long missiles, so you really don't want them to miss. They will take a long time to reload, and they cost a lot of ammunition. That's, 120 ammunition per missile? So 240 total to reload both of these. That's a lot of ammunition. Granted, they are on a cram tank, which has a lot of ammunition in its system already, so that's not too much of a big deal, but in a prolonged battle, you don't want to be wasting ammunition. You don't want to be wasting shots on misses. Detection, we do have an IR camera. It is blocked left by this radar assembly, which is blocked to the right by this IR camera. Is also blocked to the right by this missile laser emitter, which will, of course, guide the missiles, but it blocks all right-side vision. So anything over here is pretty much not going to be able to be seen by this tank. Now, it does get 0.7 detection, so it will know there's something beside it, but it has very little accuracy. Not that that's a big deal, because it's not going to be able to shoot anything beside it, but, that's something to consider. What really matters is that the forward detection is unobstructed, and that's what you really want with these with this kind of tank. You want to be able to see everything in front of you and target it very accurately. So to that effect, we have an IR camera gimbal tracker, the radar 360, and, of course, the IR camera 360 to make sure you pinpoint whatever you're aiming at. In the back here, we do have a hull pipe, which tells me that, and there's 3 of them, which tells me there's a rather large engine there, and of course some repair bots. Now let's delve into the internals of this thing. A lot of metal being used for armor, and we do have heavy armor beams on the side. Not often you see people investing in a whole 4-meter heavy armor beams in this tournament, for the simple fact that they are just hideously expensive to use. But I see a very good reason for that in this case, because you do have all of your ammunition right here on the outside, and that's the only layer of armor you have between them and the next unfriendly shell to hit this section, aside from the ERA, which will ostensibly, hopefully prevent heat from getting through, but because it's on the outside, the kinetic and explosive impact of the heat shell has a liability to actually wipe this off before it can actually stop the jet of the heat. So that may not have been the best design, but who knows? There's the chance it'll stop something. That said, anything other than heat is going to have a bit of a time trying to get through this. High explosives especially are going to struggle immensely trying to get through this defense. Penetrators like Sabo and maybe even some high caliber heavy frag shells might actually get through that, but you might need more than one hit to do it. Here are the ACBs that drive the wheels left and right. Here's the AI. Of course, it's in the front again, where usually the heaviest armor is set. Very compact. The fact the local weapon controller for the cram cannon is set up attached directly to the AI. You don't see that too many times. Usually there is a wireless transmitter connecting all the weapons. There is a transmitter connecting these missiles because they're just so far removed it doesn't make sense to link the AI all the way through here physically. But I think that is a bit of a good backup that your AI is directly linked to your cram cannon. Unfortunately, it does mean that it's right in the front. There's only 1, 2, 3 meters of metal between this local weapon controller and unfriendly fire. And that means that anything that penetrates past that is going to start hitting valuable things like this AI mainframe. You kill that, and of course the tank is dead. So there, I think it's a little too vulnerable from the front, but still, a decent amount of armor. Does have heavy armor blocks on the sides to protect the cards and everything, but you really don't want this kind of vulnerability leading straight into your AI core. Granted, that takes a bit of a lucky shot. Has to go right underneath the gun barrel, straight through the middle to hit this, but, you know, it's a risk I wouldn't take. Granted, you know, you make sacrifices when you build these things to achieve what you're trying to achieve. You have to make sacrifices in certain places, and I guess this is one of them. It leaves me with a tight sphincter because, you know, the possibility of getting a one-shot AI core on a cram tank, my only cram tank, which is can be a real game-changer if it hits, it's a bit nerve-wracking. Anyway, this is the main cannon. It goes all the way through the tank. We do have some hardener pellets back here, which I did not expect to find. Usually they're just straight HE, but that does give it a little more penetration. I'm wondering, it's got to be a devil trying to find it. Is that it? Nope. It's going to be the devil trying to find it. But I'm wondering, oh, there it is, the fusing box. Let's see what's in here. Yep, penetration depth and inertial. So anything that bounces these shells is going to cause them to explode immediately, so you won't waste that shot if it bounces. It also has pen depth, so if it actually does hit a target, it will try to go through 3.5 meters of whatever armor it hits before it detonates. Hopefully get detonating inside the tank, causing massive catastrophic damage. Of course, the lowest possible angle to explode, well, not the lowest possible, 0.5, basically any sort of bounce or ricochet is going to cause this to explode. So hopefully, even if you bounce this shell, it will. The hope is that it will still have the opportunity to do some heavy splash damage. As we all know, crams do a lot. You see right there in the UI, in the middle of it, 3,163 kinetic, but 11,645 explosive with a 34.1 meter radius. That is a lot of explosive power at a very huge radius for it to burst in. And we also have fragments. There's 37 fragments. Cram cannons have a special function of the fragments. If you have, what is it? I have to remember now. Yes, when the fragment count exceeds 60, we don't exceed that here, but the damage of each fragment will increase rather than the number of fragments. So basically, any shell can only have 60, up a maximum of 60 fragments in it. Doesn't matter how big it is. But if you have extra frags, then those extra frags stop becoming extra fragments, and they add to the damage of each fragment. I don't know what the default fragment damage is, but I don't know. It may be something like 100. But that's still quite a lot of power. You know, the frags will help to scrub things off the surface and maybe punch through a little bit. The explosive is definitely going to be powerful. And the kinetic and the armor pierce is only 30.4. This is with 100% compaction of the shell, which will take forever. There's no way you're going to get this kind of result out of every shell in a combat situation. But still, 30.4 after 100% is not a lot. So you're probably not going to penetrate too much with this. But still, against lightly armored targets, this is death. This is absolutely death. And against heavier targets, it's still going to cause major problems. Any sort of cram. And you'll notice, this is only 1320 millimeters. It's only 1320 millimeters. Not the biggest cram shell. Still very lethal. An 11-second reload or 10.5-second reload, you can get quite some use out of this. It's just a matter of whether or not the AI decides to point it in the right direction. That's pretty much it for this tank. There's the engine in the back, 400 horsepower. Not a whole lot, but definitely as much as all it's going to need for this kind of tank. There are no ammo producers, as far as I can see. So there's really nothing besides the wheels that you need engine power for, and there's not a whole lot of those. So that's it. That's the Demolition Tank Destroyer. I think it's a very well-built tank. We've seen in previous episodes the AI actually is pretty problematic for this tank, so we'll hopefully see a change in that in the next battle, but that's it for that one. We'll go ahead and get its neighbor here, the full-stop light tank, And this thing is really cute, but surprisingly deadly. Very, very fast tanks. You watch the combat episodes for these for or the one combat episode for this team. The full stops are incredibly fast, and they have a knack for going backwards and forwards, and in kind of a controlled manner, not the usual jittery fashion you see on most AI guided tanks. They're very hard to hit, and not that lightly armored either. Look at all the metal in here. Heavy armor beam for the turret to sit on. Very compact. You know, there is the chance that you'll punch through this side armor here. It's spaced, or not spaced, it's like 2 to 3 meters of metal, depending on if you manage to hit the one spot where a control block is. Excuse me. But still, that's a lot of metal to be going through for a light tank. From the back, it is pretty vulnerable. There's just these slope blocks protecting the engine. You punch through the engine, you go straight to the AI core. But you know, you have to hit it from the back. And these things, like I've said before, are very hard to hit. They do use differential drive. They have two sets of wheels. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Nope. So 40 wheels total. All of them power wheels. That is a lot of power the thing's going to require. Not so much. I mean, a lot of power it's going to put out as far as speed goes. They're only, let's see. Wheels are only 5 blocks a piece, or 5 power a piece. I can't talk. What are we? Yeah, max power use is 5. So with 40 wheels times 5, you're actually going to need 200. This is actually underpowered for the amount of wheels it has. See there, it has 100 horsepower. It's actually going to need twice that much just to run at full speed. So they're not even using their full speed capacity here, and they're still incredibly hard to hit. Now, that's pretty much it for the tank. Let's look at the shell type it's using. And it is using something slightly larger than 60. I think it's using 100 to 101 millimeter double-barreled cannon. We'll put it at 101 to be generous here. Nah, I think 100's about right. It's bothering me now. Okay, it is a solid warhead body shell with a sabot tip. You can see it gets decent muzzle velocity, right at 600 meters per second. But that's a lot of damage to come out of a shell that size. That's a fifth of the maximum you can get. 500 millimeters is the maximum shell gauge you can get out of an APS gun. And for a 100 millimeter cannon, that is a lot of damage. And they only take 4 seconds to reload. So with a 24 armor pierce and 1572 damage, that's gonna hurt. Especially, like I say, for a light tank, this thing is very well armed and armored. Let's take a look at the gun real quick. The gun itself. This is the telling part because the stats on the shells may be amazing, but the gun's too small or not correctly built. You're not going to get the maximum effect out of it. And right away, we see where the ammunition is on this tank. You see right here, it's on the very top, right underneath the turret. That may seem like a bit of a design flaw, and you see here there is internalized ERA to help provide more defense against heat. I like that setup. It does do a much better job than the external ERA setup. So very well built. You might think though that having ammo right here on the top is a bit of an oversight, but having this big turret on top is going to protect it. Unfortunately, it does have ammo clips directly above the ammo storage. So if these go up, the whole tank goes up because those are going to explode. These are going to explode, and if we look underneath, the AI is directly underneath them. So blowing up the turret, not killing the turret, but actually blowing it up, blowing up one of these clips or autoloaders, it's pretty much going to be a one-hit KO. At least I think it is, in theory. It might be a little bit different in practice, but still, that's going to be kind of unfortunate. It could be the explosion actually runs into the turret block and then spreads out from there, in which case this may not killing these may not actually kill the ammunition and blow up the tank. But still, that's a bit of a risk you take. I do like the thought though. It's going to be hard to actually reach that with all this armor here, the spaced armor there, and the turret does, because of its build right here, you see how square it is, it's going to provide protection no matter which direction it's pointing. It's not going to expose those ammo barrels or those ammo crates. We do have 4 belt-fed autoloaders, so we know that the autoloader or the shell reload speed is not going to be a problem for this tank. With only 4 seconds and 4 belt-fed autoloaders, it's not going to take any time at all to reach pretty much any sort of fire rate. It is going to have a reload period when all these run out of shells and the clips run empty. It's going to have to wait for them to reload, which could be a bit of a problem. But, you know, with 3 of them in play and as hard as they are to hit, not so much of a problem for a tank like this. We do have a bit of a lack in the cooling department. There are some. Not as many as I think this tank probably needs to get the most out of its belt-fed autoloader system and the shell type, but, excuse me, I still think it's decent. And yes, it is 100 millimeters. So, let's, I know I didn't go ahead and fire the demolition tank destroyer. I was planning to do that all later, but I'm kind of curious to see exactly how these work. There is a rangefinder up there, not armored because it is covered in armor. You see right there, all the slopes and everything are going to pretty much protect it. You have to get really lucky and hit this exposed piece hit sticking out the side here. We do have some recoil absorbers in the back here to keep the tank from flipping itself over when it fires. And on top, we do have another camera gimbal tracker to add to the accuracy of the gun. Let's go ahead and actually give this one a whirl. And then we'll move on to the Mammoth tanks, and then I'll move back and test fire and drive the demolition tank destroyer. Because I am curious about this one. I want to see how this works. I have a feeling it's a very clever little tank. I've seen them in action. If you go and watch their combat episode, I forget who they fought, but they fought the blank on the name here, because it's like foreign. It's some sort of brigade or whatever. I forget. It's a Swedish name, I think. But yeah, they fought against them and lost, but these tanks were very effective compared to some of the other ones, and I really liked how they performed. So let's take a look at this. Right away, we see they get up and go pretty quickly. There is 37 meters per second, 38 meters per second. It looks like this will reach about 40 to 42 meters per second before it pretty much caps out. Let's take a turn here and see how well they handle. They turn a bit slower than I thought they would, but they do not tip over, so that's a very good thing for the gun. Let's test fire while we're moving. Come on. There we go. And you see right there, the coolers are going to be the limiting factor for this tank. I'm going to turn it straight so I can actually see what I'm doing. Let go of the turning controls. Oh, and you see it does tip a little bit there when I let go. Come on. Reload. It's not the reload that's getting it. It's the barrel cooldown. And that's what I was worried about. The coolers on this are not sufficient to actually make use of all the belt feds. With that kind of cooldown rate for the barrels, you probably could have just gone with regular autoloaders and let it just let the cooldown self-regulate the tank's fire rate. Belt feds are going to just add a needless limitation to the function of the tank. Instead of having the continuous fire rate that you could get without having to go into a reload period, you're using a device that could potentially boost the fire rate out the window, but it's limited by the fact that the gun can't cool the barrels down sufficiently. So, yeah, that's just my thoughts on it. Overall, I like the tank. I think this is a very well-built little tank, especially for the size, and the cost isn't bad either. But, you know, it could have been done better, I think. That's enough of that. Let's get on to the Mammoth tank. And I will get back to the demolition tank destroyer. We will test fire and drive it. I swear on my soul, I'll get it done. But I want to see these beasts first. This is what you'd call the main attraction. Let's turn this UI off. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I fell in love with these tanks the moment I laid eyes on them. The first time I had to review them to make sure they were rules compliant. Oh, my gosh. I was just like, baby. Oh, my goodness. I love well-built tanks. As far when they're well built, when they have a lot of power and they look amazing, it's so nice. I can really appreciate people going the extra mile to build something that not only functions well but looks spectacular, and these things look amazing. That is two separate APS guns in the same turret, and they are each, let's look at this, 293. It's almost a 300 millimeter gun. Two of them in the same turret with four missiles, two on each side. Now, granted, they are small missiles, but, I mean, do you see the kind of firepower this thing has, potentially? Well, let's just not talk about it. Let's look at it. Let's see here. I do apologize. Recent cold weather plus the cold I had a couple weeks ago is still messing with my ability to talk without coughing up a lung. All right, let's look at this. Really interesting little wheel setup. You see there's two wheels next to each other, a gap, wheel, gap, two wheels, and then there's evenly spaced wheels in the back. That pattern is repeated four times across the tank. You see two sets there, two sets here. Come on. And I'm willing to bet these are all power wheels as well, because it seems like this whole team runs on variable drive. Yes, it does. Yep. All of them are variable drive tanks. That means that they're all going to steer by reversing one set of tracks or wheels and making the other set go forward. That's they just spin in place. I like the guards on the side. Very interesting look. I wonder if they're just pure armor, if they actually function for something else. No, they're pure armor. The ACBs are kind of stuck in here, which is very creative, I think. A hit to the flank could potentially wipe out the ability for one set of tracks to steer. It'd have to be kind of lucky, but a high explosive can eliminate a lot of the luck. That is only a layer of ERA and metal guarding that block. So losing that could affect the tank's performance a bit, but still, not the worst kind of critical hit that you could get. The engine is, again, seems kind of be the Achilles heel of all these tanks. The engine is, of course, in the rear, so it's lightly armored, and you could take this out pretty quickly. It is 200 horsepower, and I think that'll be enough to drive these wheels. Let's see. I said there's 4 plus 5. That's 9 times 4 is 36. 36 wheels times 5 is going to be 180. Yeah, that's right about what you need for this setup. Unless you have, as long as you don't have like ammo processors or anything in here, you should be fine. There is a battery bank in here, though, on both sides. Each of them does have an electric motor, so it has a little bit of reserve power. You see there, 53 reserve power when it's fully charged up. Not a whole lot, but enough to, you know, back up the system if it gets overloaded. The AI is down here. I know it's hard to see, but it's been blacked out, but that is the AI setup. Very similar to what you find in the other tanks, buried right underneath the turret. And yes, that huge block of metal above me is the turret. This is only 2 meters tall in the center, this hole is. The rest of that is all turret, and you'll probably see why in a second. There are ammo processors in here. It seems to be two of them. Ammunition stuffed all up in here, and this is why I suppose there is metal here to protect from ammo detonation. That turret certainly does not need to be hit by any sort of explosive power. In the front, we have one ERA space. There is a lot of armor here. See, 2 meters of metal, space, another meter of metal, ERA on the inside to keep heat out, space, another layer of metal. Ugh. And I like this design. It's very smart. Unlike Panzernacker, which had the in the space setup, it had a lot of armor and then spaced, but then it had the ERA on this side of the space. The space was right where the ERA is on this tank, and then the ERA was right here, which meant that once the heat exited, the frags would spawn on this side and then hit the ERA, potentially destroying them before they could stop the actual jet, which is the very dangerous part of the ERA of the heat shell. This is set up, I think, in the proper way. The heat has to hit these before it can spawn fragments, so it'll stop it cold, and no frags will spawn. Unless, of course, it's using a secondary charge, in which case this tank is boned. But still, with as much armor, and yes, space does provide an armor layer. For heat, it counts as a 20 armor class block. No health, of course, but armor class is all you need to slow down heat. And against other types of shells, a space really does kind of give a little bit of a buffer, especially against explosions, which would shear this off and then kind of have to cross this gap and then hit this. It just gives a little extra free distance between you and any sort of incoming damage, which is nice. It doesn't cost anything. It does, you know, push the damage a little further away from your tank. It does end up making your tank more bulky, but, you know, you get more out of it. This bottom layer is protected by two sets of 3-meter heavy armor blocks, which is nice. That's going to keep, hopefully, once the damage finally whittles its way through here, this is a big old stopgap against any sort of damage hitting these very valuable and vital ammunition pieces. And that's pretty much it for the hull of the Mammoth, because the entirety of the tank is really the turret. So let's get into the turret, shall we? Let's take a look at this big beast. Yeah, and that's why it's so big. There are two 293-millimeter gauge APS guns set in this thing. It is just incredible how much he stuffed in here. 2-meter shells. Let's look at the shell type before I go any further here. I'm going to have to sneeze again. Excuse me. This cold can take a hike anytime it wants to. Or the residue can, anyway. This is a heat shell that these things fire. They both fire 293mm heat shells. Let's look at it. Base bleeder, of course, to make the shell a little bit shorter, keeps it within the 2-meter range instead of pushing out to 3 meters. I'll show you here in a second, I'm assuming anyway. Yep, you see right there, if it had an extra gunpowder casing, it would get a little extra speed, but it would be requiring a 3-meter shell rack, and that takes a lot more room. So he's used a base bleeder, which has a maximum length of 100mm, to keep them within the 2-meter the 2-meter range, drops it by about maybe 5 meters per second. Not a huge sacrifice for the ability to shorten the shell. We do have, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 autoloaders per gun for these both of these massive 293mm cannons. A lot of coolers, a whole lot of coolers, way more than the full-stop light tanks have. I don't think the barrel cooldown is going to be the limiting factor for these guns. I think it's going to be these autoloaders, which are fairly numerous, so that should give it a decent amount of reload speed. 293 has a base reload of 17.7 seconds, but when you have 6 of these, that means you can fire once every 3 seconds. So that's going to make this a rather lethal tank. And remember, you're not getting hit with one shell every 3 seconds, or actually just a little under 3 seconds. You're getting hit with two shells, two 293mm heat shells pumping into you every 2.8 seconds. Yeah, that's pretty nasty. Granted, it's going to eat up ammo like nobody's business, but hey, that's just the price you pay for being that awesome. Let's look here. Yes, you do get 100 ammo per shot, so you're going to have to reload 200 ammunition every time you fire these guns. And that's why he has ammo processors to keep up with that demand. I think this is a very, very amazing setup. There are more lethal guns in this tournament, I think. We've already seen a couple of them. Panzernacker, I think, off the top of my head. Slugfest, of course, has an absolutely devastating setup. But this is kind of at the top of the list as far as just, like, OMG-type weapons that you see in there. This just, it just makes my toes curl thinking about what this will do. If it gets on target and it can hit you consistently, this is going to cause problems for you very quickly. You want these things gone as fast as you can get them out of here. Up here we do have the coincidence rangefinder. It is armored to give it a little extra defense. I think this is the only detection equipment these tanks have, and this might be the biggest problem with these tanks. With only one rangefinder, and you can see here, there is a like the little seat here. If you want, this is definitely where I'm going to sit my avatar in a second here. But if you want to have something this powerful, you really want to make sure those shells count. Granted, you can spam them a little faster than some of the other tanks in this team, but still, you don't want to be wasting 100 ammo or 200 ammo every 3 seconds. It's just not a good idea. And to that effect, I think just having this one rangefinder, granted rangefinders are very good at targeting land targets, which is all they're going to be shooting at here, but still, I think you'd at least want a tracker or something to kind of narrow down the field of fire and make them more accurate. This seems a little underwhelming for the amount of firepower you have. You really want a good detection suite on here. But who knows? This may be all it needs. And I do love the fact that you decorated this this cupola here for the commander. I'm going to enjoy sitting there just a second. And the little antennae are just a great addition. Before I get into the driving and firing of this tank, I want to look at the missiles. They are there. They do count. Variable thrusters set to 6,000, so about the same speed, just a little slower than the demolition tank destroyers' missiles. Again, the 0.8 ramp time, which is interesting. Only a 2.0 warhead arming delay. There's not the 2.2, which makes me think that 2.2 on the demolition tank destroyers' missiles were indeed a bit of a mistake. I could be wrong, though. Fragment warhead, kind of a splash damage type of frag missile. 30 is narrow, but not super narrow. They'll just kind of splash against the target, soften up armor, take off vulnerable blocks. These are just basically spam missiles that you throw at your opponent, add a little bit extra damage in there, maybe knock out some weak targets or some crippled targets, or make their life just a little more, bit more miserable. You do get 4 of them per tank, so that's 8 of them if both mammoth tanks are shooting at the same target. So that's not an insignificant amount of damage, and they get there very fast. So you don't have a lot of time to react. They do have designators on them, so they're fairly accurate. You just have to hope that that laser stays on target. Excuse me. Oh, I didn't notice this. They actually have two different types of missiles. So the inner set, you can see over there on the top left corner of the screen, the inner set are the frag missiles. The outer set are actually high explosive missiles. So you get two types of damage, and they just kind of keep coming in. With only 60 ammunition and what is it? 30-second reload? No, hold on. It's five. I think it's what? Is it 2 to 5 seconds per gantry? I can't remember. I'm gonna say 5 seconds. That's a 15-second reload for each of these. They're gonna be coming in pretty consistently. So over time, that barrage can wear you down. Not as significant as some other missile barrages in this tournament, but still, that's not an insignificant amount of damage that's coming in from these tanks. All right, and that just adds to the pain that those double 293 millimeter heat cannons are going to be dealing. I can't sadly put either a vehicle controller or fire control computer up here, so I'm gonna have to sneak it in the back here, and hopefully, I will be able to reach it from the turret, because I'll be darned if I don't drive this thing from the spot provided for me by the host. I don't turn down gifts like that, especially not on a tank like this. All right, let's hop in this guy. Can I reach it? No, I can't reach it. Ah, that's frustrating. I can fire all the weapons from here though, so let's take this out. Take you out. Put this. Can I reach it from there? No. Oh, come on. Don't make me do this. Ah, there we go. Okay. I sneak it in right there from the depths mechanics. Look at that. Connect to a slope. Yeah, do it every day. All right, let's get Big Bessie underway here. Oh, it's a slow beast. Not too slow. Those wheels do get up and moving, but it takes a while to get it up to speed. And you see, we're getting upwards of 30 meters per second. Not nearly as fast, though, as the full stop light takes. And of course, they don't get up to speed nearly as fast either. Let's hit that variable drive, spin it around a little bit here. Gonna park it kind of catty corner, and yes, we're gonna use the poor full stop light tank as the testing buddy here. Sorry, little guy. All right, and I'm going to have to sit in this thing. Oh yes. Oh, he put predictors on here. Thank you so much, based Aerolfos. That will help my atrocious aim be a little less atrocious. Oh, just hold still. Get the cannons on. Oh yes, hold still. It will all be over soon. Can I not fire both of them? Oh, do you see the designators? That's a pretty big shot there. Can I not fire both of them? Why isn't the other one firing? Oh dear. There's the other one. Oh no. Yes, we popped the turret clean off of that one. Heat shells do not mess around, man. That is quite the barrage. Not quite sure why the other gun didn't fire immediately. There may be a delay on them. I'm going to check that out real quick here. There is a 0.7 firing delay. So they actually delay. The right one delays just a second, I guess, to give that offset firing or offset look to the firing pattern. So left fires about just over a half second later, right fires, left fires, right fires, and so forth. I guess that's how it's supposed to go. I'm gonna hop back in. I just can't help it. I love this thing. Let's hop back in and take another shot at that poor little full stop. I'm gonna try to get point blank. The turret is a bit hard to control since you're sitting in it. It's just a problem with from the depths. It wobbles a lot when you're trying to control it because it's your point of view moves with the turret now, and so it's just that much harder to actually control. Let's get you on target. I just love how slow and ominous this thing is when it turns. It's just like, dun. All right, let's see if I can keep it on target and just fire continuously here. Fire, there it goes. Keep on target, stay on target. There we go. You see, now this is slowed down because my computer's struggling a little to handle this. But you can see that the fire rate for cannons this size is pretty respectable, especially since they're using 2 meter autoloaders. Come on, hit something. Oh gosh, I can't. With this wobbly turret, I can't aim very well. There we go. Come on, stay on target. There we go. It just wobbles too much. There we go. And that one ricocheted. That's going to be the problem with these tanks. Of course, the shells are not fused, so they can ricochet. But still, I really like how this thing is designed. Now, it won't be that wobbly when the AI is trying to control it. And hopefully these missiles can aim a little bit better than I can. But that is an impressive beast of a tank. Wow. I really like this thing. All right. I promised I'd get it done. We're going to go over here and get this demolition tank destroyer done and get this video finished so that you guys don't have to listen to me babble for much longer. There are some strange people out there who actually enjoy listening to me talk for half an hour on end. I can't really understand why, but if they like it, good for them. I try not to spend too much time doing this. I don't know why I placed that there. I can control the weapons from here. Can I? Yes, I can. I will sit here and command from the top of the tank because, well, you can't really get inside the tank. All right. Oh, oh, wow. That actually got up a lot quicker than I thought it would. That's actually kind of scary. The fastest tank on the team might be the tank destroyer. Now, granted, I can understand why. You kind of want the you want this thing to be able to turn to get where it needs to go and to turn on a dime so it can get itself facing the right direction. Can I spin? Can I spin to win? Can I turn? I want to demonstrate this thing on the biggest, juiciest target that this team has to offer. I'm going to have to hit reverse. There is no way I am ever going to be able to. Oh look! I did a thing. I spun it. Yay! Let's see if I can do it again. We're gonna turn. Yeah. Okay. Yes. I like this. This I like. Okay. Stop. Okay. Yes. Yes. Turn. Nope. Turn. Turn. There we go. Turn a little bit more. And I'm going to get close range because if you think my APS skills are bad, it's the crams are even worse. Now, I am going to have to be quick with this because I have to aim the cram and then quickly aim the missiles. Oh, I may have donked the cram. That's okay, though. You see, even from that distance, as far as I missed it right there, it still rocked the... It rocked the Mammoth a little bit because it has such a wide radius. I actually burned some wheels off of it. I'm going to wait for this thing to reload. Get a little higher up. It has a very, very slow shell. In previous matches, this thing has really struggled to actually fire or actually hit targets. Well, actually, you just fire the cannon. And I suspect that's because this has a very, very slow shell, meaning it actually doesn't have a lot of reach. It has to get within shotgun range before this can actually hit. And you see right there how far up I aimed it, and I'm still just landing underneath the Mammoth. Granted, landing underneath the Mammoth was more than enough. I have just shredded the entirety of that tank. The explosion ran up underneath, blew the underside out of it, and blew the turret up from the inside. That's just with a 10.5 second reload. Imagine if I had hit that tank with a 100% shell that I fired the first time. That 100% shell was still enough to rock the tank after impacting right here. Think about that. Imagine one of those little full stops sitting right there and not that big Mammoth. I'd have blown half the side clean off of it with a 100% shell. With a 10.5 second reload, that was the 100% shell takes, I think, roughly 150 seconds to... For this cram to reach 150 or to reach 100%, let's look here. Yeah, we're just hitting about 17% density after. Let's see. So at 30 seconds, you reach 19% density. So it will take you roughly 150 seconds to get this thing to 100% density. That is that's quite terrifying. At only 20%. I could blow away a full stop with this cannon. That's the power of a cram. A really well-built cram is quite terrifying. The problem is, well, it depends on AI to get it to face the right way because it doesn't have a turret. And, well, if you look here, the meters per second for that shell, if you look on the second main box for the gun, shell diameter 1320 millimeters, muzzle velocity 85 meters per second. It fires so incredibly... such an incredibly slow shell. In fact, I'm going to demonstrate right here, hop back on this thing, and show you what I mean. It fires so incredibly slow that even if I angle the gun all the way up. I'm going to get to the maximum elevation I can get for it without... Come on. And it has quite a bit of elevation, which is great. Now, that's not going to do me much good because I kind of want it to go forward a little bit. We're going to put it right there. Even at that elevation, it can barely get... Let's see. We're gonna measure how far it lands here. That's looking about 500 meters is what it's going to land at. That is a very low-range shell, especially for this tournament where your opponent started 800 meters. Right here is the detonation demolition tank destroyer. Okay, 700 meters. Not bad, but it's still not going to reach the battle line of the enemy when they start. So this thing has to close, and then it has to... You saw how long it took me to angle that gun up. It's going to take a while for it to actually get the gun on target to hit something, unless it's sitting right in front of the cannon. And even then, it has to trust the AI is going to keep itself aligned with the target long enough for the gun to get the azimuth and elevation right. It's just, you really kind of need to watch your shell speed when you're building a cram. Low velocity crams can have a lot of benefits. The problem is that their accuracy and the time it takes to set them up can actually really gimp your tank. But overall, I like the demolition tank destroyer. I like the way it's set up. It's just a shame that its AI seems to be a bit derpy. And that is it. That is the death in the shape of a Panzer Battalion. And I really enjoyed this team. I hope you guys enjoyed this review. And I hope to get some more battle episodes out soon. In fact, this is going to feature in the next episode, so stay tuned for that. As soon as I get access to the forums again, I will have that one uploaded and ready. So keep your eyes peeled, and I will see you guys in the next episode. Bye-bye.